going to break another one. Safely over the top of Bruce's head. Safely away from four.
Botham hammered a bowling attack of Lilly and Alderman to reach 149 and give England the slender hope of a 130-run lead going into the last day. Now the match would be in the hands of fast bowler Bob Willis.
Yeah, well, I'd batted with Ian at the end of the innings, unfortunately left him stranded, not out. So I felt a bit responsible having got out to try and make a fist of this.
Pants on fire, I suppose, would be his style of bowling. Arms and legs everywhere, hair blowing, and he would produce some searingly fast deliveries.
Really was a difficult delivery. He's gone. God is in despair. Oh, good catch. Super catch out.
He bowled magnificently. Frightened them to death. It's always nice to see an Australian going white.
'56 to win, Willis to March.
Bob was in a different postcode. He was in a different world.
In the air, Dilly's underneath it. And he's got it!
Every time he took a wing, you had to run further to catch him up, to pat him on the back.
When the Eskimo gets here, the pitcher's gonna run to him. Well,
and throughout, he just, you'd look just like that, and you're just, it's all...
Bowl in, it's all over, and it is one of the most fantastic victories ever known.
Thanks to Willis, Australia were all out for 111. This was only the second time in Test history that a team had followed on and won. Botham's genius determined the remaining tests as England took the series 3-1, and it quickly became known as Botham's Ashes. The Botham effect contributed to England beating Australia again in 1985 and 1987. But as he reached retirement, his achievements posed problems.
Wonderful, glorious cricket, what it was, still sort of thrills the spine. But the effect, I'm afraid, was damaging to English cricket. And Ian Botham himself, obviously, not responsible in any way for that. What happened was that English cricket decided that the status quo was sufficient.
The England cricketing establishment relied too heavily on the innate talents of Botham and had been lulled into a sense of complacency.
The first time India have beaten England at Lord's.
Heavy defeats against what were considered second division teams resulted in questions being asked about how English cricket was organised. Was it still too amateurish? In 1990, there was a new captain, Graham Gooch, working with coach Mickey Stewart. They decided that in Margaret Thatcher's Britain, the old way of doing things had to go. Like the economy, English cricket needed to be leaner and meaner.
In my early tours with England, you could really turn up for an England tour having done nothing at all, not touched a bat, not done any training, anything, and no one would ask any questions at all. And I didn't think that was right. So when I became captain, I tried to instill, along with Mickey Stewart, the coach, you know, a more professional outlook in terms of the way we prepared.
Those who didn't go along with this tough regime of bench press cricket were in trouble. And this was the case with David Gower. Gower was a silky left-handed batsman, the heir to the flair of Dennis Compton.
David Gower, I think, has been one of the most exciting cricketers during my lifetime. Fabulously gifted batsman to score all those runs so effortlessly. And that was the thing about Gower. He never looked as though he was really trying.
Short and again, it's beautifully played by Gower.
Gower, the public schoolboy with a relaxed approach to cricket, would once have personified the amateur ideal. Now he was a threat to the new order.
The Gooch Stewart era was, in a sense, a reaction to what I'd have to call my era. You all had to, in the simplest of terms, conform to this system. My innate character could not agree with that. Let's face it, I was never a keen fan of, you know, running. And therefore, to be in effect told that you have to conform, you know, we're all going running, we're all doing this, we're all doing that, we're all doing this together, was too simple and slightly alien.
And of course, there was a bit of resistance, you know, from some fairly senior players. Nowadays, absolutely, you know, second nature now. No one would argue now.
This was a curious echo of the past. This time, with the old establishment turned upside down.
There was definitely some form of class division. I think the England captain, Graham Gooch, the England team manager, Mickey Stewart of Surrey, just didn't like David Gower. Because certainly they drove David Gower out of the English test setup two or three years earlier than he would otherwise left of his own accord, because his face didn't fit the new, very narrow, chippy, professional English setup.
But better fitness and match preparation couldn't stop the rot in the 90s.
In that era, other sides were progressing. Sides that before you just thought you'd just turn up and wallop were now really emerging with some superstars of the game, and England had stagnated.
That's it. 300 test wickets for Wesley Macgrath.
Not only were England losing to the cricketing powerhouses of Australia and the West Indies, they were being defeated by India, Pakistan, New Zealand, Sri Lanka, and even Zimbabwe. For a period in 1999, England were bottom of the world rankings, officially the worst team in the empire of cricket. It was time for England to eat some humble pie and learn from its former colonies. Following the Australian example, an elite academy was set up, run by former Aussie wicketkeeper Rod Marsh. Zimbabwean Duncan Fletcher was made head coach, and a new captain of Indian and English descent had a message for the new millennium.
We have to start winning, and everyone that plays for England from now on in has got to realise that that is the most important thing. Everything that spins off from that are extras. The 11 that take the field from now onwards, under my leadership, will be there just to win games for England.
Nasser Hussain was a strong leader, with no interest in the leftover baggage of England's cricket history.
The essential attribute of Nasser Hussain is a fiery passion, and he directed his whole being into stopping England losing. He would think about cricket all day and almost all night during a test match. He was absolutely consumed by his mission.
Well, he's played some wonderful shots today, has Nasser Hussain. None really any better than that one.
We decided in the selection to stick with people and look at the long-term objectives of the team. And probably that is when the first seeds of that 2005 Ashes team were starting to get planted, just then, as to not who's going to beat Zimbabwe and who are going to be good players for now, but who are the tough people, the mentally strong people, the talented people, the people that can bowl 90 miles an hour, that will ruffle up Australia and really good players.
Under the partnership of Hussain and Fletcher, England won four consecutive test series, including, in 2000, the first against the West Indies for 32 years.
That's it. That is a magnificent victory.
Success was further underpinned by the adoption of another Australian innovation. Players were contracted to England, not their county sides, to commit them more fully to the cause.
If you ask me in 1990 who I played for Essex. And maybe occasionally England would ring up and say, what are you doing this week? Do you fancy a test match? Whereas after central contracts came in a lot later, I think the players, the Triscothics, the Vaughans, the Harmisons, the Flintoffs, felt like